Thank you very much. My name is Carolien Lichtenberg, and the talk of today is Experimenting with the City of the Future. I want to talk to you about how temporary design in urban space can be an experimental playground for permanent development. I will talk about three projects today, but to understand a little bit how we work or how I work and why we do it like this, I will talk about my background, the time frame we live in, and also why architects are at stake in this type of projects. So my name is Carolien Lichtenberg. I'm an architect. I have a small firm, let's say, focused on redevelopment of vintage buildings and complex areas. The office is very small, but the network is very big. That's also how we work. For every project we do, we build up a custom-made multidisciplinary team. My background, very quickly, just to understand a little bit where I come from, I worked at really big firms like MVDV, OMA, Michael Sorkin Studio in New York, and Enric Marais in Barcelona. But then I went, let's say, after having really experience in complex buildings and designing, I went to Barcelona and I became director of studies in an institute which is called Institute of Advanced Architecture of Catalonia. And this institute is a postgraduate design school, an international school, but also in a research institute on how societal changes, let's say like digitalization, could be implemented in the spatial domain. So there were all kinds of researches going on. It was all in process, etc. But Barcelona taught me also something else, and this is for me even more important, that the social life of people in Barcelona is very, let's say, warm. There's a very big connection in between generations. People are very empathic and, let's say, they celebrate the life, and also with a less materialistic way than we normally, or more formal way than we in the northern countries are used to. So decorating streets with just recycled material as an effort of, let's say, all people living in the street, and I organizing dinners and just celebrating life. And when I came back to the Netherlands in 2009, it was crisis, and yeah, let's say almost in contradictory to what I found in Barcelona. There was lots of vacancy, empty plots, but also kind of depressive feeling in, let's say, kind of social decline in some neighborhoods in the big cities. And it made me realize that, although we are architects and focused on how we can build and how we can just make, let's say, quality of life, that we should really integrate and open up our way of working, because, let's say, not the idea of making sustainable cities was by, let's say, stacking up the building process. We just not lose our job in creating cities, but we had to do it another way. So we had to integrate more the social aspects of life and trying to understand what technology could bring us besides, let's say, the physical domain. If we really quickly look at the global trends, then we see, of course, that there's so much changes going on that we really should understand as architects that our job is differently from, let's say, more stable times. Cities with which are polluted, anonymous life, the nature which is very much under pressure of, let's say, economical issues, let's say, this kind of digital revolution. We still don't know if this is, let's say, threatening us or if it brings us prosperity. But what we really do know is that we all want to have a more natural, more connected, more healthier life. And we also know that we have to do it together. Now, so why architects and designers are now needed? We are very much used to think 30 years ahead. So we know that we want to think about what is life in 30 years. And if we are now in such a, let's say, time of radical changes, then of course we can create very nice images and seductive paintings and drawings just to convince that we have to build it how we drew it. But this process of, let's say, just design it from behind the drawing table, then build it, and then just to realize it, and opening it up to the public and the users, I think we should really reverse it. So we really have to first open up the site or a complex building or an empty building, trying to involve other people, then start designing and then building it. And so this new strategy, also how we are working, and I show you later on three projects, is opening up to the public, learning by experiment, because you can use the time to understand what is next step in life and next step in applying those social and technological issues into the project, and then applying or implementing it to the permanent development. As said, I will talk about three projects. They were in different time frames, so they also differ a little bit in size and in impact. I start with Cousin Slope, and then I talk about Kleiburg in de Belmer in Amsterdam. Cousin Slope is in Rotterdam South, and then de Belmer, and later on I talk about Fab City Nature, which is the project we are working on right now. Cousin Slope was a temporary hotel in the Afrikaanderwijk, a very vulnerable, socially vulnerable area. And we did a temporary hotel and all the vacant apartments and buildings which were in the area, spread over the area. And we involve local artists, local entrepreneurs, try to explain and to collect as much stories of the neighborhood, trying to give people who are there as a visitor a really authentic stay, but also connection to the site. Later on, this was a very big success because we also had, let's say, educational projects going on there. It was a very big success. And the developer just made a decision to keep the project as a permanent hotel in the area. This was all before Airbnb even existed. So the local community runs the hotel. If we then look at Kleiburg, it was the next project. It was, let's say, mid-crisis. And Kleiburg was then at that moment the last empty honeycomb flat in de Belmer. It was waiting for renovation or demolition. So we had to come up with a strategy to make it more attractive. And one of the first things what we did was organizing a dinner in one of those inner streets of the flat. And those inner streets, they were public and always a symbol for insecurity and criminality. So by just first starting to make a very big dinner with 120 people in a kind of romantic setting in which was completely not romantic at all before, we could really reverse from the first moment on the sentiment of this building. And also, let's say, by having it shared all over social media, we could completely have another image going on already. Then we were building up, a community of like-minded people who were all very much interested in the do-it-yourself home renovation. And it made that everybody could really do what they want in this flat, but living together then in this completely big building, having everybody its own place. In the end, Kleiburg also got the Mies van der Rohe Award and also the Dutch Design Award. And I think it's a nice model which we can apply in different, all over Europe in the outskirts where you have those big scale 60s and 70s flats. The last project I want to talk about is Fab City Nature. It's a project what we're doing right now. And also there, we try to understand how we can use the temporary phase as an innovation phase for the permanent development. I have a small, it's a 1 minute video, and it explains the concept, what we do in Fab City Nature in IJmuiden aan Zee. And then it's explaining the, let's say, the concept before we started the execution phase, and that's what I will talk about later. So 1 minute of video.
IJmuiden aan Zee, a unique place in the Netherlands on a crucial crossing point. A number of different, powerful raw identities and qualities collide. In the next decade, a new coastal town will arise here, outside the mainland, protected by dikes and dunes. On this location, coastal development, flood risk management, climate change, sea level rise, urban development, new identity, new ways of living and working, and the life of tomorrow come together. In this project, we're working on innovative models, prototypes, typologies and processes, also of value for implementation elsewhere. Different, powerful and raw identities collide. We connect apparent contradictions. As the front runner of the permanent area development, Fab City Nature explores the potential of the area over the next 5 years. Fab City Nature is built on three pillars: campus, community, design. Fab City Nature offers the opportunity to discover how we can develop a truly climate-proof, sustainable coastal town in IJmuiden aan Zee. Fab City Nature is an open platform in which we will learn to build with nature. Fab City Nature is an international showcase in which area, urban and nature development and climate change come together. Fab City Nature enriches the Fab City Global Network.
Yeah, so this is or was the concept of what we wanted to do in IJmuiden aan Zee as Fab City Nature. And now we are in this execution phase, opening up the site. So it's the site around the harbor. And we are building up the community by having a public program there. And also I want to emphasize here that if I say that we want to open up a project before designing and building it and opening it up to the public, then I don't mean that public is just interviewing some inhabitants in a neighborhood trying to ask what they need or what they want in the neighborhood, but that we have to build up a community of really, let's say, where we can really find out what is next step. So this is a mix of business, educational people, startups, but also inhabitants, people from the municipality, so that we can see from all corners and all kinds of expertise what we should do. And then as architects or as designer, we are able to, let's say, to formulate next steps in an area. So in Fab City Nature also had this public program. And of course, that also is an online program where we can share knowledge, share also the program, have an online identity. And we started to have just very light program inviting other people to the site and opening up spots in the area, which are, let's say, spatially interesting, but where you normally don't come. So we had some cinemas, but also again a dinner in a boat's house, trying also to create another sentiment in this area. Now we are in the phase where we built just a campsite with all tiny houses, and it is an experimental playground for how do we live in such an area on a more smaller basis, where you can just experience how it is to live on a, let's say, with a small footprint, also deconnected and off-grid from water and energy, all being very self-sufficient. We do also, because this is one of the main issues also, that we want to see how natural processes can be involved in the development. So not all, let's say, artificial bulldozering what we want to do there, but using natural forces as well. And this is one of the, it's a biosanitary unit. And also we want to see how we could use this type of water and sanitary systems in the area. We also have a communal space where we can have meetups and understand how we will proceed in next steps. So next step is to build up more the campus, and the campus is more about, let's say, a kind of professional life in inviting experiments and building up a more startup mentality. So we do, for example, tours with experts across the whole site to have their input to see and also to feel what the site is about. So the next step, what we're doing there, is learn more. We have to understand what we can do there, build this kind of incubator campus, so that we know that building a really sustainable coastal town, that we know what we have to do. And what is also one of the parts we really want to understand is what is another type of lifestyle. This is not urban lifestyle and it's not nature lifestyle, but can we make a crossover? That's the point where we are now in Fab City Nature, and we are going on, but I want to wrap it up a little bit. Like I showed three projects, Kussenslope, Kleiburg and Fab City Nature. They all have this same approach by having a temporary phase before the permanent development. It was different time frames and different types of projects, but they all resulted in some new quality and new sustainability for the permanent development. So Kussenslope, very light, Kleiburg as really trying to understand how we can build a new community of new inhabitants, and Fab City Nature really to see also, let's say, now ending or having a post-crisis idea, how can we really look further and understand what is a sustainable development. And in the end, we really have to, let's say, models which we can apply in, let's say, same places elsewhere. The conclusion of today is, or what I wanted to talk to you about, is that in this time where still, let's say, we have radical changes socially, digitally, and technologically, that we really have to learn and to reconnect by experiment, that we have to use the time to understand how we can design sustainable cities for the future. I think that we really have to act now, and that we have to do it together. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.